Good morning, everyone. I have to tell you, I'm seeing some of the best looking masks, I think. You win the award for fashion masks this morning. It's good to be with you. It's good to be here in this place. I know there's still some people congregating, so I'll invite you to come in and to find a space. As we quiet our hearts and our minds, turn our eyes upon Jesus, and prepare our hearts for worship. What a great way to start worship. Will you join me, please, in the call to worship? You, God, are our God. Earnestly we seek you. We thirst for you. Our whole being longs for you. We have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power. Because your love is better than life, we will worship you. We will praise you as long as we live. Because you are our help, your right hand upholds us. We will praise you as long as we live. Well, it is good always to see you, to be with you this morning. And, you know, this is a new normal for us in the church. If you're visiting with us for the first or second time, we welcome you. And if we don't have any information from you, because we normally would pass the attendance pad at this time, we're asking you to, up on the screen is my email, pastorcarrie123@gmail.com. And I'm asking if you would just send your name and information to that email, then we can connect with you, get you connected to our church email, and you can be aware of all the things that are going on. And there is a lot going on. You can also just call the church office, and that phone number is up there as well, 513-804-8088, and just do that old-fashioned thing called making a phone call and talking to somebody or leaving a message. So I also encourage you at any time during the service today, you know, if you're one of those folks who's figured out how to use that camera on your phone, how many know how to use the camera on their phone? All right, we got a few there. So at any time that you want to pull out your phone and point it, open the camera app and point it at the screen and take a picture, I won't be offended if you do that. It's a wonderful way to remember things you want to remember, and also as we go through our sermon notes today, to take those home with you. So as you all probably know, if you've been coming to church, we are, for now at least, not singing, and we have added some audio recordings. We have a wonderful music from Eric Bristol coming today, but singing is one of the ways that we know that the virus spreads probably faster than anything else. So to keep us all safe, we're going to ask you to praise with your hearts, but not your voices today. And I love that scripture from Colossians that says, you know, there are so many different ways for us to praise the Lord. He wants all of us. Come on in. Also, just a reminder that if you're coming to church next Sunday, we'd like you to call and let us know that so we can plan for the number of people that will be here. And this will help us keep everybody separated, social distancing still in place here at church. We're so grateful, aren't we? And just blessed to be able to meet. And I'm so thankful for our trustees who figured out all the spacing in our sanctuary to make sure we're all safe. Also next week, we're celebrating communion together for the very first time in a long time. I'm looking forward to it. As you know, we usually pass the communion elements down the row, and we will not be doing that this coming Sunday. But we will, as you come into church next week, we'll have little communion, individual sterilized communion cups for you to take to your seat. These will be set up in the lobby, and so make sure that you pick one of those up as you come in, and we will walk you through what to do. But we will celebrate communion together again, which will be a great time. So I know there's lots that we've been doing, and we're going to show you some of those things in just a few minutes, but I want to invite our kids to come up for our children's message. One on each side of me. I love it. How are you? Things been going good? You been staying busy? What you been doing that's been fun? You've been coloring a lot, okay. Anything? What you been doing that's fun? Calling your friends on the phone. Yeah, it's hard to not be with them, isn't it? To not play with them. Well, so what we're learning today, I'm going to ask you a question. This is a math question. Are you good with math? Do you like math? Okay. Here's the first question. How many ears do you have? Two. Here's the next question. How many mouths do you have? One. Why do you think God gave us two ears and just one mouth? Yeah, we can... Sorry? We can speak with our mouth and hear with our ears. But why two of these and only one of these? Any ideas? All right. I'm going to tell you what it says in the book of James. He wants us to use our listening more than our talking. He wants to listen, us to listen to each other, you could say, twice as much as he wants us to talk. He says, be quick to listen and slow to speak. And he's talking about this in relation to when we get into an argument with somebody. Have you ever been in an argument with somebody? What do you tend to want to do a lot when you are arguing with somebody? Fight, yeah. Do you talk more, do you think, than you listen? I do. I know I do. I tend to want to tell them what I think, right? But he's saying we need to do just the opposite. Instead of talking so much when we're arguing, we need to stop and listen to the other person before we talk. That's why we have two ears and one mouth. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you've given us wise words. Thank you for your word that we can listen to and read. Thank you for helping us know what to do when we're in a disagreement with someone. Remind us to take time to listen first and speak less. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Thanks, guys. See ya. Thank you, Eric.
Yeah, absolutely.
Music is so powerful in bringing us into a place of prayer and a place of quiet. And I don't know about your life this past week, but it seems sometimes hard to find places of quiet. So I want to give ourselves a gift this morning and give us some space to just come before the Lord in our hearts and minds with some quiet time. And as the Lord brings people or situations to your mind, just allow that to come and lift them up as a prayer to Him. Let's begin our silent prayer. About a year ago, Jerry Howard made a commitment to pray for me each Sunday morning before the service started. And Jerry and Kyoko have been at home watching the services online, and they've missed being here. But Jerry still sends me a prayer every Sunday morning. And this week I asked him if I could share it with you, because it was beautifully written. And I think it kind of speaks to where we are. This is our prayer together. Our dear God in heaven, please hear our prayer. So far, Lord, the year 2020 has been stress-filled. It is already the last Sunday in July, and we cannot even imagine what life is like for those who do not know you. Those who do not have you to lean upon. How difficult this world must seem. But we thank you, Lord, that we do have you, and we have our church that is called to continue to bring your healing and your presence and your love to those who don't yet know you. We thank you. We thank you for your word that aids us in dealing with all that's going on. We thank you that through this church, we can see and try to understand all sides of the unrest in our nation today. No matter how dark this world seems to be, we know with you, there will always be a joyful dawning. Please be with, guide, and protect our church as we serve you in Jesus' name. And now we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray together as his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today we are celebrating our special mission offering, as we do on the last Sunday of the month. And our mission offering today will be going to Matthew 25. I love that quote. on the front of their sign. Matthew 25 is a ministry that provides nutritional food to the hungry, clean water to the thirsty, clothing to the naked, affordable shelter to the homeless, medical care to the ill, and humanitarian supplies to those in need. It collects excess products from corporations and manufacturers, as well as the general public, and ships these donations to those in need. We thank you for your support over the years, not just financially, but the volunteers that we send to Matthew 25 to help this amazing ministry continue and flourish. So thank you in advance for your giving today. Also, as we prepare for our offering time today, we want to share with you something that Hearts and Hammers has been doing. So I brought Mark up to talk about it.
Thank you. About a year ago, a little less than a year ago, this story begins with three boys going to church. It was Elizabethtown United Methodist Church, where it's a sister church of ours, and Jane and Glenn Lash serve there. These boys came to church, and they had a story to tell, which ended up changing a lot of people's lives. There were a lot of people from this church and others who serve. There were people in our congregation who served food, gave money, and gave of their time and their talents, which is just an amazing thing to me. When I think about this, Pastor Carey, it's why we're here. We exist for the Great Commission, which is to go out and make disciples of Jesus Christ. And the best, one of the best ways to do that is to equip people so that they can serve and learn the love of Christ and God's grace, which when you see the video, you'll see the look on everyone's face that was serving. So there's many, many ministries that are going on in this church. This is just one of them, but it's a really faith in action example of what our church is doing with ministries. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark. And the video kind of shows a progression. It goes on for a little while, but I'm going to encourage you to stick with the story as you watch the pictures of the transformation of these three boys' trailer that when they started had no heat, they had no beds, they had a kitchen that was working. So let's just go ahead and start the video.
Wow.
I'm going to give you an opportunity. I want to thank Martha Bryce for really kind of beginning the brainchild of Hearts and Hammers, which is doing work in the community to help people. And I just want, how many of you, if you were involved in any way in the Elizabethtown Project, would you just stand for a moment and help us to thank you? Thank you so much. Thank you. I remember being in the trailer as people were working all around us, and somebody asked me to come back to the back of the trailer, and Mike and Amanda were back there, and they said, "We just want to ask you something." And I said, "What? Ask me anything." They said, "Why are you doing this for us?" And I just said, "Because we love Jesus, and he loves you." And they couldn't quite grasp it. It was early in the process. I think they understand it a little bit more. I've asked them, we're probably going to be seeing this family come to our church and tell a little bit of their story in October. I talked with Jane yesterday, and we're going to work that out. So hopefully there is more to come. But their story is not the only story. There have been several families that Hearts and Hammers has blessed, and we will be looking forward to giving an opportunity to talk about that in the coming weeks. So as we lift our offering, what an amazing example of what God is really wanting from us. Not just our money. He says, "I don't want your sacrifices. I want your whole life to be given to me." And how blessed we are when we do that. So let's pray this prayer of offering together. And as you leave today, just a reminder that the baskets for offering are at all of the exits as you go out, and you can just drop your offering there. Let's pray together. O God, maker of heaven and earth, you are our help in the midst of need. You are our hope in the midst of hopelessness. You have called your church to bring good news to the poor. Thank you for what you have done through us to bless these people. May these gifts and tithes be used to do the same for more families, so that the love of Christ can be spread through our community, one family and one home at a time. Amen. Our scripture this morning are two short scriptures, one from the book of Proverbs, chapter 15, and the other from the book of James. So I invite you to read this with me. Proverbs 15:1 says, "A gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger." And then our reading from the book of James. "Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, it was 12 o'clock noon on Santa Monica Boulevard in Los Angeles, California, and I was looking for a place to have lunch. Just a couple of months before, I had moved from Medina, Ohio, population 26,701 people, to Los Angeles, California, population millions. And I hadn't yet learned in my time there that looking for a parking space at noon was a contact sport. But it was. Just a couple weeks before, I had run out of ketchup around dinner time. Jeff was traveling, and so I decided I was just going to run to the grocery store and pick up some ketchup. And I got there and pulled into the three-level parking garage and drove up all of the levels for about 15 minutes without finding a place to park. Decided to just go home without the ketchup. It wasn't worth it. But now it was noon and I was hungry. And so imagine my surprise when I drove past a Subway with a parking spot right in the front. As quickly as possible, I pulled in the entrance, turned my car into that parking spot. Unsure of my amazing good fortune, I turned around to see a man with his car running and the door open and him standing with his fist in the air, yelling something in another language that I didn't understand. And then I realized what had happened. He had come in the other entrance with his eye on the same parking spot that I just took from him. So as I watched him shake his fist at me, I have to admit, anger started to well up in me. I started to think of a number of things I could say to him. I have just as much right to this parking space as you do. But then something came over me. And I guarantee it wasn't from me. It was a word of guidance, let's say. Because as he was standing there shaking his fist, a crowd had started to form on the sidewalk. These people were waiting for a fight. The Spirit said to me, "Show them something different. Show them who I am." And so for no reason at all that I can logically explain, I turned to the man behind me and I said, "Do you want the spot?" He didn't quite understand at first because he kept shaking his fist at me, so I said it again. "Would you like to have the spot?" And I climbed back in my car, turned it on, put it in reverse, pulled out, and ushered him in. As I was pulling around the corner, I saw the faces of the people who had gathered. Their mouths had dropped open. That's not something you see every day in Los Angeles, California, on Santa Monica Boulevard at noon. And as I pulled around the corner, amazingly, there was a parking spot, another one for me. I walked into the Subway. Guess who was right in front of me in line? He didn't say much. But what I learned that day, there is power in being a peacemaker. Our topic today is called How to De-escalate a Conflict. And there are two things that we're not going to learn today because we don't find them in Scripture. One thing that we're not going to learn is that Christians should always cave in when there's conflict. Christ was not a caver. Almost every day, he was confronted with people challenging him on something. He didn't cave. He stood firm, and he spoke his truth. But he did it God's way. I was talking with somebody last week, and they said to me, "You know, I'm getting to the point today where I'm afraid to say anything." Do you ever feel like that? You use a phrase that someone doesn't appreciate, you say a word that is taken the wrong way, and it's like a tinderbox is going to explode. And I don't know about you, but what I find myself doing is just getting quieter and quieter and quieter. I don't want to make anybody mad. But we're not going to find anywhere in Scripture where it says that Christians should always cave. We are not called to be popular. We're called to be powerful. We are not to cave in. We are to speak out. James 3 says, peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. Another thing that we're not going to learn today is that Christians should always run from conflict. Sometimes we think that we should nice ourselves to death. You know what I mean? Christians are just supposed to be nice to everybody. When I think about the niceness that I see pervading in the church and Christians not speaking out or standing their ground or speaking their truth, I think about what happened way back in the book of 2 Samuel. The story of David and Goliath. If you remember this story, David was the shepherd that God had appointed to eventually become king of Israel. But nobody knew the strength of character in him yet. Until he showed up at a battle site. His brothers had been sent to fight the enemy, the Philistines, and David was bringing them, I don't know, lunch. And when he got there, what did he find? That all of the soldiers that were meant to fight the enemy had retreated because they were so afraid of Goliath. And this just didn't sit right with David. He said, "What are you guys doing running from the fight?" Then he said, "I'll go. I'll fight Goliath." I love this phrase when he says, "You come at me with a sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord my God, the Almighty God." And he defeated the enemy because he wasn't afraid of conflict. He didn't run. Sometimes we are called to face conflict in order to fight evil. James says there is power in doing it God's way. Why does it matter? Why are we talking about this today? I think the world today is immersed in conflict. Would you agree? Our nation? And every day I watch the news to see evidence that the conflict is de-escalating. I'm not seeing it. At least the pictures I'm watching on television. We are engaging in conflict that is escalating to a dangerous level. When people resort to violence, it seems like they have the power, but they really have no power. Escalation comes from desperation. Violent people are desperate. I think it's a condition of spiritual poverty. When we escalate, we're counting on no one but ourselves for a solution to the problem. James says, there's power in being a peacemaker. Peacemakers, he said, who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. So we sit back and wonder today, what do we do about this situation? What do we do about these conflicts that continue to escalate, now going on 8 weeks, maybe 9 weeks? What is going to change it? If caving in a conflict is not the answer, and running from a conflict is not the answer, then what is the answer? What I think James is telling us today is, don't shout what you believe. Show what you believe. De-escalate the conflict by bringing God's power into the center, standing our ground, speaking our truth, and not being afraid. I want to share with you 5 ways to de-escalate a conflict, and these come from several different scriptures. But James is kind of the main scripture that we're using today. So let's look at 5 ways of de-escalating a conflict. Number 1, turn down the volume of your voice. Don't we feel like we should do just the opposite when we're in the midst of a conflict? But there's something powerful about bringing down the volume. I remember when I was teaching golf, for about 3 or 4 months, for some reason, I completely lost my voice. Probably because I was talking all day, every day, and my voice just gave out. But I still had to show up at my work, and part of my work was teaching 10 or 12 people how to play golf all at the same time. But all I could do was whisper. I didn't know if it was going to work. But I started out with the lesson, and I said, I just want to let you know I've lost my voice. Do you want to guess what they all did? They moved in closer. They leaned in, and every single eye was riveted on everything I was saying because I had lowered the volume of my voice. Some of the people in those classes told me that they were the best classes that they'd ever taken. It was a humbling experience for me. Turn down the volume. It says the quiet words of a wise person are more effective than the shouting of a leader of fools. I love that translation. Number 2, turn down the speed of your speech. Fools, it says, give full vent to their rage, but the wise bring calm in the end. Did you ever notice how quickly the people that we're watching on TV, the talk shows, when there's 5 of them on the screen and they're all vying for attention, how fast they're talking? I remember being in a meeting in a ministry planning session with a pastor who had been in ministry for many, many years. And all of us who had been in, you know, ministry a couple years, who thought we knew everything, were just talking and talking, and here's my idea, and here's my idea, and here's my idea. And after about an hour, this man had not spoken a word. Somebody turned to him and said, Bill, what do you think? And he just sat back in his chair, and he took a breath. And it seemed like 5 minutes before he said anything. But once again, we were riveted, waiting to hear his words of wisdom, because he slowed down the speed of his speech. There's power in the pause. There's power in peacemaking. Number 3. This is what our kids learned this morning. Tune up your hearing and tune out your talking. James 1:19. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak. 2 ears, 1 mouth. Nothing more needs to be said. Tune up your hearing and tune out your talking. Number 4, turn up the sensitivity of your heart. What does this mean? I love this scripture. Proverbs 14:10. Everybody, say it with me, everybody has a hidden hurt. When you are in the midst of conflict, you and I rarely take the time to think about what is the hurt underneath the desperation in this other person. But when we take time to tune up the sensitivity of our heart, we will discover some things under the surface. We're going to talk about this more in coming weeks. And number 5, talk less, pray more. I'm going to give you a challenge the next time you're in a conflict, and it seems like it's escalating, that you take a time out. Jeff and I have learned that we have to do this. We've not ever mastered this. I think we're still working on it after 25 years. But we take a time out. We separate. And in that time, if we can begin to pray, you will be amazed at the peace that will come over you, even though the situation hasn't changed a bit. Wisdom's instruction is to fear the Lord, and humility comes before honor. Proverbs 15:33. Take time out to pray. You know, you and I are probably one step away from a conflict when we walk out the door of our house in the morning. In every situation, we're called to stand. Stand for truth. Stand for Christ. To do whatever it is we need to do in a way that honors God. Sometimes the conflict will tempt us to be nice instead of speaking truth. Sometimes the conflict will tempt us to run when we are meant to come out and defend God, just like David. Sometimes the conflict will look like a man with his fist in the air in the parking lot at Subway. And you and I all have an opportunity to show that crowd that wants to see Christ how he would take care of the situation. There is power in being a peacemaker. And there is power in his presence. Let's pray. God, we think about these things that you've taught us this morning, and we think about all the ways that we have failed, all the ways where conflict has gotten the best of us, or we have run away because we don't want to face it. And you know that about us. And we're so grateful, Lord, of your patience with us as we grow. We thank you that tomorrow morning we get a new start. We get a chance to do it differently. We pray that you would take over our heart and show us the way of peace. We ask this in Christ's name, our peacemaker. Amen. We have one more slide, a reminder of who we are and why we do what we do. And I'm going to ask you as we finish today for us to read this together. Our vision is to connect and serve all people so that lives are transformed and empowered through the love of Christ. I am blessed to serve with you according to that vision. Be blessed and see you next week.